All right, what the heck just happened to the stock of The Real Real? This company's the world's largest online consignment shop where you can buy and sell used luxury apparel and accessories. The Real Real had the misfortune of coming public in late June, right before the markets soured on IPOs. Its stock tumbled from $30 at its peak on the first day of trading down to 12 bucks and change in August. Ouch. The company has an intriguing concept, though. It's growing like a weed. So the stock started to bounce right back, climbing to $23 a couple of weeks ago. But then The Real Real had a rough week. Last Monday, they reported an excellent quarter. It's a nice revenue beat with a smaller-than-expected earnings loss, a nice forecast bump, too. At the other same time, though, the stock would have probably roared higher the next day. But right after the quarter's reported, a CNBC investigative piece said that not every item is authenticated by experts. And a number of people at The Real Real employ to handle this may not have the expertise to do the job. Now, in response, the stock fell more than 10% last Tuesday. It's still down more than 5% since the news broke. And that's why we would like to hear from Julie Wainwright. She's the founder, chairperson, CEO of The Real Real, to find out what is going on. Ms. Wainwright, welcome to Mad Money.
Hey, thanks. Thanks for having me on.
Okay, so Julie, let's deal with some of these issues. There are some questions, and I know you even put out a note about to our customers and consigners about counterfeit, but some people say maybe there's not enough Real on Real Real. How do we?
Oh boy. That? So first of all, that was former disgruntled employees, and I want to talk about what we do today because it's really different. So let me give you some stats.
Okay.
All right. We've sold 11.5 million products. Our net promoter customer score is 70. 80% of our GMV is from repeat customers. Now put that aside. Let me tell you about what happened in October. We process 490,000 units.
Mm-hmm.
Our copywriter slash authenticator team removed 4,000 units before they ever got posted. Before it went.
Removed 4,000 units because they were not acceptable?
They were counterfeits.
Okay, and they determined that a copywriter who may not, that's a person who is an authenticator at the same time?
Well, here's what we do. Look, when I first started the business, copywriters only copywrote.
Okay.
And they went to authentication. Later on, we blended in the copywriter authentication.
Okay.
Each copywriter authenticator gets 30 hours of training.
Okay.
They sit with other people. There's master authenticators. So, yes, they plus the expert, the high-risk authenticators, mm-hmm. remove 4,000 right away.
Okay. So then
our QC team pulled another,
quality control team pulled
another 139 from the site. So, if you just look at that's what we do every day. Our brand is to keep fakes off the market.
But, you know, that's difficult. I mean, our CNBC investigation team interviewed nearly 36 former employees, including 3 that appeared on camera. And there was an internal document that they got that shows the copywriters are subject to strict quotas, and that therefore could mean that there are fakes getting on the site because not everybody, it's a tough model to scale to have all the really have great authenticators.
Oh, gosh. All right. First of all, let me talk about your documents. They were 2 years old. They're not even relevant.
Well,
all right. But secondarily, let's address your point.
Okay.
We use a combination of data, technology, and humans to drive the authentication process. And it is hard. There's no doubt about it.
I mean,
it
you admitted
hard.
In your statement it's hard to get every fake out. And the people who make fakes are pretty good at it.
They are pretty good, which is why we keep iterating our process. So what we did even in August of this year doesn't look like what we do now.
Okay.
We have to keep iterating, and we get smarter all the time.
Okay, well, here's what confused me. I mean, as someone who used to trade for a living, and this is, it's two sides of every story. 95% of your stock is sold short. That's almost as if I could argue that there's a conspiracy, or I could argue that people must think that you're going out of money, run out of money, but you have a very big bank account.
Yeah.
You have a lot of money in the bank. You have $370 million.
Yes, we have a lot of capital, and we have a really firm path to profitability. We have more than enough capital to get us to profitability. So, look, the whole short seller world's like a weird world to me. It's sort of the anti-darkness thing.
Understood.
But that's not where we live. We live in creating a great brand, a great company, and making sure that we actually keep fakes off the market. We do it every day. But we also provide an amazing service to our consigners, which keeps them repeating about 80% every single year.
Okay, so talk to me. You've got a deal with Stella McCartney. You just announced a deal with Burberry. There's a very real outfit. Some people are telling me, including some very good analysts, that there's a possibility that a Louis Vuitton could be coming or a Richemont. Is that a likely, or is that just a pipe dream?
You mean in working with us?
Yeah, be a partner.
Well, we're There's some really strong laws going on in Europe that raising the visibility of the environmental impact of fashion, both fast fashion and luxury brands.
Right.
Those laws are forcing them to reconsider their sustainability pact with the planet, and they have to change. So I would say, yes, I'm in discussions with big brands right now. And it really is to get people thinking about the circular economy and getting them reinvesting in, on the planet.
Do you make your life hard by giving statements periodically about how everything is real when we all know that no one is perfect? Sotheby's is not perfect. Christie's is not perfect. Do you set yourself up to some degree for a level of criticism that may be justified because it's impossible to be perfect?
I agree it's impossible to be perfect, but we strive to be perfect every day. And that the team's intention every single day and their actions, and by the way, and our consumers tell us that we are the safest place to shop on the internet, and that's what we do every day.
Okay, so let's go back to this notion of a copywriter and authenticator. Why is there a difference? I mean, if you're training people, they're either copywriters or authenticators. I'm confused about, you know, for instance, there was discussion in the piece about how some authenticators for Chanel versus Fendi, that some products got authenticators, some products got authenticators. And to me, it does seem a bit of a jumble.
No, it's not. Again, the copywriter title is a throwback to when we first started.
Okay.
And by the way, let me just say, that's going to go away because we're automating copywriting using machine learning. So by the first quarter, the majority of things will be written by a machine. So the title is sort of an old title.
Okay.
But, and the job is changing pretty dramatically even as we speak with machine learning and AI.
Well, explain for our people who may not be as savvy on this. Machine learning meaning that they're able to spot fakes? Machine learning be a...
So a copywriter, let's talk about their old job.
Okay.
So their first job was they literally looked at a piece. They checked to see if it was fake.
Mm-hmm.
They wrote what you saw on the website. They physically wrote it through a combination of pull-down menus and writing it. Now, and what we're moving to is things are authenticated, a photo's taken. It extracts all the attributes and preforms the product. So they won't even be writing things. They'll be checking it. So their job is changing pretty dramatically. But I think the key is nothing static. We keep changing. And a combination of machine learning, artificial intelligence, and changing our processes. And we change them because, A, we're getting smarter and we know it works. And, B, we have to change because counterfeiters get smarter.
Will you be able to make across the board, like not have it so that some shoes are authenticated by some authenticators and some dresses are by copywriters? I mean, you're just going to go steadily across the board.
Well, the copywriter job is changing pretty consistently. But, look, when things come in, let me just give this will help. I think this will help put things in perspective. Our GMV, about a third of our revenue that we sell through and get in, is fine jewelry and watches.
Right.
Those go off to gemologists and watchmakers.
People that we would, if we were Christie's, we would call on those people.
And many of our people came from Christie's and Sotheby's and Tiffany's and Rolex. So those experts. Some things, because we have a lot of great AI, we know have a high risk for counterfeiting.
Right.
Those go off to our master authenticators, and they tend to come from the brands.
Mm-hmm.
So they're coming from Fendi or Louis Vuitton or Tiffany or Christie's or Sotheby's, all right? So they do go off. They need an extra level because we've known over time that's where the money is. Other things went to another level, a group, the low risk, and they still authenticated. The difference is they won't be writing copy in the future at all.
All right. Now, understand, our report I thought was a good one and that the network stands by it. At the same time, I think there's two sides to every story. You have a very good, fast-growing business. Have you gotten feedback from the piece? Are you worried about trust in Real Real?
I worry when anyone takes a one-sided shot at the company.
Remember, again.
I know that's your story. My story is I built a business over 8 years. We have a net promoter score of 70.
Which is Apple 68, so that's a very good number.
It's a good number, and we always work every day to keep our trust, every single day. So regardless of what people write about us or what happens to the stock, our business just keeps getting stronger, and the team is focused on both keeping fakes out and providing a great service to the customers.
All right, well, I want to thank you for coming on. I think that this is the new frontier of retail because people don't want their stuff to go to a landfill. And there's lots of good stuff that is worth a great deal that we don't want to do that either. So I want to thank you so much for coming on. That is Julie Wainwright. She's the founder, chairperson, and CEO of The RealReal. It's an $18 stock. It was at 30 at one point, down to 12. It was at 23 before. The quarter was a good one. Mad Money's back there. Right.
Don't miss a second of Mad Money. Follow at Jim Cramer on Twitter. Have a question? Tweet Cramer. Hashtag Mad Tweets. Send Jim an email to madmoney@cnbc.com or give us a call at 1-800-743-CNBC. Miss something? Head to madmoney.cnbc.com.